one enemy is the devil himself. The devil comes to kill, steal, and destroy, and he's taking names and kicking butt, and he don't care who's in the pathway. He'll take you and your family out of here if you're standing in the way. Number two, the world is our other enemy that we find ourselves fighting. You know, the world's agenda says this, but God's agenda says this. And if you find yourself with one foot in the world and one foot in Jesus, you'll find yourself on your way to a dim destruction. Well, we find ourselves not only fighting the devil and fighting the world, but we also find that the number one enemy is the enemy in a me. Sometimes it ain't what the devil throws at me or what the world throws at me, but it's what's already down on the inside of me that I find myself battling with. And so some of you are fighting depression demons and self-esteem issues and diseases and self-control issues. Can't help myself. And some of you are struggling with forgiveness, and some of you are struggling with trust issues, but the greatest enemy is the enemy in me. It seems like ever since we signed up for the Christian life, the enemy has been after my family and after my finances and after my future. And sometimes it's sitting down and negotiating with the enemy ain't gonna get it, baby. Sometimes I gotta go square toe to toe and let the devil know, you can't have my family, take your hands off my finances, and you sure ain't got nothing to do with my future. High five somebody and tell them, fight on. So if you expect to win battles in this lifetime and ultimately walk away with the victory, you've got to do battle on a spiritual level. And just when you think that you can't give anymore, hold on any longer, God says to you, never lose your fight. Folks are losing their fight on a daily basis. They're losing their grit. They're losing their drive. Every day I hear about, for every two murders, there's a suicide. And that's somebody who just gave up on life. There's students that are dropping out and not even completing that last year. You think I'm going to go to school for 11 years and not stick in there to the 12th year and drop out just short of the glory? But you got folks dropping out and quitting on school. And then you got 50%, over 50% of the marriages for the first time are quitting, divorcing, before even 3 years hits. I tell you, a lot of folks are losing their grit, losing their fight, losing their gusto. And so as you struggle and you strive, I came to preach a prophetic word to you that God showed me to come by on today and encourage you to fight on. I don't know what your situation is. I don't know what you're dealing with. I don't know if it's a physical or spiritual or emotional thing. But God is telling you on today to listen to the words of this passage and listen to the words of this sermon and just fight on. And I just want to know if you want some handles on how to keep holding on and keep fighting even when your energy has given out. I just wonder if I got some folks in here interested in what it takes to keep holding on. You're about to lose your fight. You're about to lose your finish. You're about to lose your faith. But God is saying, keep holding on. How am I going to do that, God? I got four things and I'll be out of your way. Number one, you got to use your weapons. And what are those four weapons? Number one, the word of God. Number two, the blood of Christ. Number three, some prayer. And number three, some praise. I'll be out of your way with these four points, and I promise you, I'll bid you ta-ta. In your right hand lies one of your first weapons. Everybody hold up your right hand. Hold it up in the air. I need you to grab down the word of God close to your heart. The word of God. When Jesus was tempted in the wilderness by Satan in Luke chapter 4, he overcame the devil with one weapon, the word of God. And rather than sitting there arguing with the devil back and forth like we do, Jesus simply quoted the word of God and applied it to the suggestion that Satan had for him. When Satan tried to suggest a course of action for Jesus to prove his divinity and satisfy his hunger, Jesus answered him with the word of God. He said, it is written that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. I just want to know that if you know that you got a weapon in your hand called the word of God, you need to use the word of God. Profess the word of God. When you wake up in the morning, confess the word of God. On your job, start speaking the word of God. I know they're going to put you out of it, but you can just hum it in your spirit. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. Lord, I thank you right now. You got to hum that word in your spirit, and sometimes you got to speak it. I'm more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus, which strengthens me. So the word of God is your first weapon. Now lift your left hand up in the air. And your second weapon is the blood of Jesus. Pull it down. You've been beating yourself up over something that happened to you last week or last year or even before you got saved. And it's got you so down that you're about to lose your fight. But Revelation chapter 12 verse 11 lets me know that we overcome the enemy by the blood of Jesus. And 1 John chapter 1 verse 9 tells me that if I confess my sins, he is faithful and just to forgive me of my sins and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. I don't have to live a defeated life because of something that I did years ago. But Jesus is saying, I've got forgiveness waiting for you in the blood of Jesus Christ. You can sit around and mope and dope if you want to and act like you ain't got no life because you messed up. But guess what, baby? You ain't the only one that messed up. And what you messed up in ain't the worst that you can mess up in. So God can forgive you and you can get up with the blood of Jesus Christ. Stop letting the enemy defeat you and tell you that you are what you messed up in. You are more than what you messed up in. Don't allow the world to define who you are by what you did. I'm better than what I just did last year. I'm better than what I did last week. And I've got a God who's standing there forgiving me. If I just confess with my mouth, he can cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Well, the first weapon I told you was not only the word of God. The second weapon you pulled down was the blood of Jesus Christ. And the third weapon is prayer. Now, this is the one you're going to have to grab the neighbor next to you, because sometimes where two or three are gathered in his name, God shows up in the midst of it. And I know you've been trying to pray that thing through yourself. But every now and again, you need to get an accountability partner. Call up baby girl on the phone. Call up brother man on the phone and say, I need you to pray with me. Prayer. Prayer. If you want change, you got to pray for it. If you want revival, you got to pray for it. If you want victory, you got to pray for it. If you want peace, you got to pray through it. And some of the battles, you can't praise your way through. You can't even pray your way through sometimes. You got to combine the word of God, the blood of Christ, and some good old prayer. Well, I got to leave you now, but I wanted to give you the last weapon. I need you to take both of your hands this time and lift them high. Lift them all above your heads. Two hands to pull down this thing. And I need you to pull down real hard. Real hard with a hallelujah on your lips. The word praise is your next weapon. Pull it down. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ha! See. Hallelujah is the highest praise. And every time you see me shouting and dancing, and every time you see me grabbing my head when Sister Lisa hits a note that I can't stand, or when Brother Cassie hits a run that I can't stand, well, every time you see you, it ain't just my emotions. You seeing me using my weapon at that point. Every time you see me send up a praise, I'm sending up a weapon. I'm doing battle. On one occasion, you can have a seat. Jehoshaphat, the king of Israel, came up against a vast opposing army of nations that were bent on destroying Israel. 2 Chronicles chapter 20 details it. Talks about the Ammonites and the Moabites could taste victory on their lips. They knew they were getting ready to take Israel down because they outnumbered Israel. They outstrengthened Israel. How many of you know that there's some Moabites and some Ammonites on your job and in your home that think that they outnumber you and outstrengthen you, and they can taste taking you down right on their lips? But keep on reading, baby. The Bible says that instead of King Jehoshaphat recruiting more men, he used what he had. Every now and again, it don't pay none to go get something else new. But God every now and again says, dig into your pocket and pull out what I've already given you and use what you have. What did Jehoshaphat have?